Well, good morning, Scottsdale Baptist Church Online. My name is Ryan Hubner, your online campus pastor. Whether you're joining us out of the state, out of the country, or just next door to us, we are so happy that you are here. I want to encourage you, like I do every week, to just take a moment and jump onto one of our three chats, whether on our website, YouTube, or Facebook, and just make yourself known. Just at the very least, say hi and connect with someone else online just like you. You would be surprised how God can use the digital world to build relationships. But we are not one single a person in the world. We are part of a community, God's church. And so let's act like it online. So as you can see, I have someone special with me today. This is Pastor Rich Griffith over at our Fountain Hills campus. He's a campus pastor. So today in service, we're going to talk a little bit about how God is using SBC in the Valley to impact it. And Fountain Hills is a prime example of what God is doing in the Valley. So Rich is going to share some ways that we can celebrate with Fountain Hills and pray for Fountain Hills. And so Rich, the floor is yours.
Fountain Hills is a unique community, and I've had the privilege of being there for the last 3 years and fostering a group of people to be able to do church and community right where they live. And so celebrate with us what God's doing in the community of Fountain Hills. It's about 25 minutes from the Scottsdale location, our main campus location, but we're seeing a lot of seasonal people, retirement people, but also we're seeing young families beginning to come in. And so we celebrate just what God's doing in the life of the church there. So I covet your prayers. I covet your prayers on our youth ministry, that we're able to reach that next generation. But that SBC Fountain Hills becomes a light in the community of Fountain Hills. And so we want to see people change for the gospel of Jesus Christ. We want to see transformation. And so that's why we're in this community, and that's why we are doing everything we can to foster community and that welcome spirit for people where they call their life and their home.
Amen. Well, these are things worthy of our celebration and our prayers. And so, Scottsdale Baptist Church, we are so excited to spend today with you, to spend Sunday with you, and to hear the Word of God, to sing together, to be in community. So we will see you online very soon.
Good morning. Welcome. It is great to see you all here today. My name is Kirsten Snary, the minister to women, and I'm just excited to be able to encourage you all this morning. In women's ministry this year, we have had a theme, and the theme has been focus. And it's been fun to see all through Scripture how we're called to focus. We're called to fix our eyes. We're called to remember. We're called to set our minds on things above. We're told to take our thoughts captive. And so I know you all are coming in here today, and many of you may have some distractions, and I know I do, but I would love to encourage all of us to focus this morning, to just focus on what the Lord has for us here. You may notice that there are some men missing, and that's because there are 400 of them up at the men's retreat this weekend, which is pretty amazing, right? Praise God. Well, so ladies, if you're one of the women who has encouraged, maybe nudged the men in your life to go up, thank you. I've heard from them already, and I've heard it's been an amazing weekend. So thank you for encouraging those men to go up there. One of the things I love to do in my role is pray with and for women. But this morning, I have a neat opportunity to pray for the men. So would you stand with me as we prepare to go into worship? I'm going to pray. And men, if you feel comfortable, would you just put your palms up as just a posture of receiving? And women, if you're comfortable, would you extend a hand as a posture of blessing? And I'm going to pray for us, okay? Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this beautiful day, for this place, for the privilege it is to come together and focus on you. Lord, I pray that you would calm our hearts and minds right now so that we can be focused. Lord, I want to lift up the men of SBC. Lord, I think in particular of the ones at the retreat. I know that they are finishing up this weekend and they've had an amazing time. And Lord, I pray for the encounter that they experienced with you, that it would continue in their life as they enter back into regular life. Lord, I pray that you bless them and protect them on their way down the mountain. Lord, I pray for all the men of SBC, those here at Shea, those online, those at our other campuses. Lord, I pray that you would give them soft hearts for you, but Lord, amazing strength of character. And I pray that they would seek after you with all their hearts. And Lord, I pray as they do that, that it would overflow into every area of their life, Lord, that it would overflow into them being leaders in their homes and in their communities and in business. And Lord, I pray that it would affect the way they do all those things. Lord, may you be glorified today in our worship as we focus on you. And all God's people said, amen.
Well, good morning, church. However we've entered into this room this morning, what other burdens are carrying on our shoulders, God is inviting us to come into his presence, to find rest and to find full satisfaction in him. So do we accept that invitation together as we sing this out?
Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy, come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for.
Come on, we sing this out. For God so loved the world,
for God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever.
Amen.
this is love. It makes no sense. Offers a heart with a beat that never ends. So this is grace. It keeps no score. Fixed as the skyline, vast as the ocean's floor. And who am I that you gave your life? We sing together. Praise you forever. Praise you forever. Praise you forever. My soul will sing. And what kind of king leaves a throne to live with the hungry, afflicted, the lost, and alone? And what constant hope, and what purpose?
Just take a minute to internalize those words that we just sang. Savior, come. Savior, reign. Teach me songs of endless praise. Then take this life crucified. Now death cannot claim what never can die, because this life, because our lives have been claimed by Jesus Christ. and to surrender to Him, to give our all to Him. It's not drudgery. It's not some miserable servitude, but it's actually the way, the only way to true happiness is total and surrender and commitment to this Jesus. And so we're going to pray a set of words here in just a moment, but it's in recognition of the fact that He alone, that Jesus Christ alone, the risen Savior alone can satisfy. And so if you would, could we make these words on the screen here our prayer this morning? Take, Lord, and receive all my liberty, my memory, my understanding, and my entire will, all I have and call my own. You have given all to me. To you, Lord, I return it. Everything is yours. Do with it what you will. Give me only your love and your grace. That is enough for me. Amen. In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, just give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Oh, you can have all this world. Just give me Jesus.
Yeah.
Friends, you can have a seat this morning.
As we look at our history, as we look at Jesus' vision from mustard seed to tree, could it be that God is saying to Scottsdale Bible Church, be a church for the valley?
What has happened at Cactus is simply unexplainable from a human's perspective. We intend to make it a beacon of hope and a beacon of light to this community.
God has given us the unique ability to connect with thousands of people from all across the world.
We're worshiping next to each other for this town of Fountain Hills.
Well, obviously, we're giving an update today on our For the Valley initiative. If you're newer to our church, about 2 years ago, we declared a vision coming out of the pandemic that we've aptly called For the Valley. We came out of the pandemic with a huge vision for our church to be not just a Scottsdale North Central church, but a church that reaches more deeply into the Valley of the Sun, and even with online, across the world. And so you might remember that it was a three-year vision campaign that we are now 2 years into. And the price tag for this, I'll mention in a minute, is rather large, but I'm going to encourage you today with a lot that's going on and how well we're doing. You might remember there were three components to our For the Valley vision. One was foster care. We wanted to raise a significant amount of money to do some significant things with foster care. Secondly was church development. There were a lot of churches coming out of the pandemic that were threatened and they were vulnerable. Since then, a lot have shut down. We wanted to help a few dozen in the valley here in a significant way to not be those kinds of churches. And then we, as you just saw, multi-site development. We wanted to go from three campuses to six campuses so that we might be a church truly for the valley. This was a huge undertaking. We declared 2 years ago a $35 million campaign in addition to our regular offerings, and you guys have been amazing. It's an encouraging report we're giving you today. Let me encourage you. The first thing we did was we took the first $8 million that came in and we set it aside devoted to foster care and church development. So before we spent any money on our multi-site expansion, the things that we were doing out there, we wanted to make sure that money was safe and cared for. And so since then, we've opened up Gigi's Cottage down in Mesa, serving nine gals at any one time with a safe Christian foster care environment, and we still have about $3.5 million put aside for a second foster care home. So we're doing really well there. Additionally, we set aside about $3 million to help other churches. And I mean other churches that aren't like us. We're a non-denominational church, but we've been helping Japanese congregations, Latino congregations, denominational churches that we would not usually be a part of. If they embrace Jesus, we're in. And we've helped over a couple of dozen churches with about $2 million. We're going to give a report on that soon, but it's going amazing. And again, we have about $1 million left to help other churches. And then obviously multi-site expansion. 2 years ago, we opened up Fountain Hills, and it has been an amazing success. Our Fountain Hills congregation is doing so well. Rich, their pastor, has been a great fit there. He just needs to move to the town. But other than that, he's been a great fit there. And we are now pursuing two more campuses, East Valley and West Valley. And here's the good news. Less than 2 weeks ago, our elders unanimously voted to sign on our large campus down in Tempe, which is going to become our East Valley campus. It's at Southern and the 101, and as one elder says it, it's a gateway into the East Valley. It's going to serve not just Tempe, but Gilbert, Chandler, Mesa, that whole area, even South Scottsdale. And this is really special. The campus that we've secured, and we'll talk about it here more in a second, was the original Calvary Chapel here in the Valley of the Sun. And again, if you've been around the block, you know anything about Calvary Chapel, they're a lot like us. They're a Bible teaching place. They're open to the movement of the Spirit. They're outreach oriented. And this was the original one. And they've hit some hard times, and they're going to look to buy a smaller place elsewhere. But this is a huge campus that we're securing. Over 60,000 square feet under roof and tons of parking. It's just that it needs a lot of work. And I mean a lot of work. And so that's why some of you in the video thought, 2025, like how much work does it need? A lot of work. And so it's going to be an 18-month project. We've already secured the GCs and all that. We're looking for subs, but we're lifting roofs. We're taking things down to the studs. Here's what I promise you. You're going to love it. Whether you go there or not, you're going to be proud of what your vision and our vision is accomplishing. It's going to be an exciting fifth campus that we add to Scottsdale Bible here. And we'll keep you posted. We're having a model made up of it right now. We're going to put it in the different campuses for you guys to see, and we're going to encourage your socks off. Now, let me encourage you even more. We don't talk about money hardly ever around here. We don't need to because you guys resource God's kingdom so well. But this will be encouraging to you. We are two-thirds through a three-year campaign, so we're at the two-year mark right now. We are more than three-quarters fully funded based on your gifts already. You should clap at that. That's really good. So two-thirds through, three-quarters funded. It does mean that we have about $8.5 million to go. That's been fully pledged, so people have already committed to that. We're just encouraging you to follow through as God leads you. But here is the challenge we face right now, and this isn't going to surprise any of you, and that is that there's this nasty little thing we're running into called inflation. Have you guys noticed that lately? And it's hitting us because a lot of this is bricks and mortar or construction, even with Gigi's Cottage and all of that. And so no one saw this coming 2 years ago. We're up, and this is actually good number compared to what's happening in the rest of the nation. It's been about a 15% increase. Generally over what we originally hoped to raise. So we're looking to raise an additional $5 million, cap it at a total of 40, and that will allow us to get everything done. We've set aside money for a West Side campus. We're encouraged by that. So it's a great time to onboard. If you've not onboarded with For the Valley, you can go to our website, find all about that. And if you are on board with us, and as God continues to lead you over and above your regular giving, we encourage you to give to this. Kim and I made the biggest significant pledge to this outside of our regular giving than we've ever done, and we feel so good about that. So exciting times here at our church. Our vision is becoming reality, and it's so exciting when you see that. At least for me, I say, only God. So with that said, we're going to move into our time in the Word today. We're in the book of Proverbs. You guys are going to like where we're going today. Don't shoot the messenger. This is what God's Word says to you today, and I think you're going to be challenged and encouraged. So let's bow and pray, and we're going to dive right in. God, indeed, I am grateful for what you're doing here at our church. I'm grateful for the blessings that you've given each one of us. We know we're blessed. And so, Lord, it's a joy and a privilege to give back to you and to see your kingdom, that mustard seed built in tangible ways here in the Valley of the Sun. So thank you. God, as we celebrate here, we know that on the other side of the world right now, they're not celebrating. What's going on, Lord, in the land that you have so blessed, the Holy Land, is devastating right now. So, Lord, we would not be shy to pray, as the Bible says, for the peace of Jerusalem. Lord, no matter where we stand on this issue, we would pray for peace for those who are being devastated by the war, for those who are being displaced, for the innocents that are being hurt in all of this. God, we pray that you would draw nigh to them, that, Lord, you would minister to them, that you provide relief to them. And, Lord, eventually, would you please bring peace to the Holy Land? Lord, I would pray, because you know how I read your word as well, that as I believe, God, that you have a special purpose for Israel, especially purpose for that piece of land there in the future, as you've declared what is to come, God. We pray, too, for protection upon Israel and for your purposes to come to fruition. We know they will, but we also pray toward that end. Lord, we know there's a partial hardening going on right now that someday will be lifted, and that you will lift the eyes of Israel to see the Messiah, who is Jesus. And we pray, Lord, that that day would not tarry, that that day would come, and that you would accomplish your purposes in that special place as you bring even the end drawing near. And so, Lord, we lift them up to you right now. Lord, as we turn to your word now, give us ears to hear and eyes to see. May we not be resistant to what you have to say to us, even in the tangible areas of our lives. And we pray this in Jesus' name, and we all say together, amen. So here's a great place to start. Most of you here and at our other campuses have a favorite teacher or professor from your school days. Well, most of us do. Probably because this person was smart, engaging, and they liked you. And so that made you made them one of your favorites. I've had a few over the years. Mrs. Nelson was my favorite in high school. She was just wonderful. Tom Burke was one of my favorite professors in college. And then also in college, there was a guy named Dr. John Reist. Reist was a character, and he was brilliant. He taught at Hillsdale College, where I went from 1985 to 2010. I didn't go there from 85 to 2010. He taught there from 85 to 2010. Before that, Reese served in the Army during the Cold War overseas. He earned a doctorate from the University of Chicago in theology and literature. He won numerous awards for his teaching and his love for his students, and he even preached regularly. He was a Christian in churches in southern Michigan. I would say he was a true Renaissance man. But what I love most about Reese is his wit, his humor, and his pithy sayings. He was kind of like the Tom Schrader of academia, if you remember Tom, a pastor that we all knew and loved here. One day, Reist was commenting on Christianity and business in one of the classes I was taking by him, and he made this statement. This is a paraphrase because it was so long ago, but he made a statement very similar to this, and it moved me. It gave me one of those aha moments. He said, capitalism concerns itself with the profit motive. Christianity concerns itself with the profit motive. Both are correct and both work. And then he said, and they live in tension with each other. Folks, I got to tell you, back then I was 20 years old, 40 years ago. And even back then I thought, what an insightful statement if there ever was one. Look at this again. Business or capitalism truly does concern itself with the profit motive. As we all know, it's all about providing a service or a product, and its ultimate goal is to make money, to earn a profit. In fact, if you don't earn money in business, they would say you're not doing it right and you're a failure. Our faith in God, however, through Jesus Christ, concerns itself with the profit motive. Sounds the same, just spelled differently. It's all about God coming to earth. It's about his revelation, speaking forth God's truth, and even foretelling what is to come. So business focuses on money and earnings. Jesus focuses on God's kingdom, along with faith, hope, and love. And here's the point. At first glance, and many of you feel this, they seem to be opposed to each other. One is about getting all that you can and looking out for number one. The other is about looking out for others and having a God-centered life. At the very least, many people, including many Christians, kind of see them in different spheres, divergent spheres. But Riest is right when he says that they both work well, they both hold water, and the key is to realize the tension that exists, don't miss this, learning to allow God's prophet motive, which certainly trumps all, to guide us in our business with its profit motive. And that's what we're going to do today. And outside of Jesus's teaching on this subject, and Jesus taught about business a lot, he was masterful here, there's no other better book to guide us in the Bible than the Old Testament book of Proverbs, the book we're in this spring here at our church. Now, you might remember from last week that Proverbs was primarily written by King Solomon about 3,000 years ago. What I didn't tell you last week, and this is germane this week, is that Solomon was hands down the consummate businessman. He really was. In fact, the things I'm going to share with you today, they do not come from me. Because you don't want your pastor talking to you about business, do you, Tommy? You don't want that. I talk to you guys about Jesus and theology. I'm in the prophet business, not the profit business. But I'm going to hide behind Solomon. I'm going to hide behind his words today, help you understand them rightly. Let's let him guide us. Why? Because he was a better businessman than most of you. Look at what it says in the Bible as it describes King Solomon. It says, "And the king, Solomon, made silver and gold as common in Jerusalem as stone. And he made cedar as plentiful as the sycamore of the Shephelah. And Solomon's import of horses was from Egypt and Kew, and the king's traders would buy them from Kew for a price. They imported a chariot, for instance, from Egypt for 600 shekels of silver and a horse for 150. Likewise, through them, these were exported to all the kings of the Hittites and the kings of Syria." So those of you who are in business are catching on. Solomon excelled at making money, gold and silver. He excelled in import and export industries. He knew all about trade with nations. In short, if Solomon were alive today, he'd be running multiple currency funds, hedge funds, crypto funds, import, export businesses, and he'd be advising politicians rightly, mind you, on trade with other nations. If there is anybody outside of Jesus himself who can help us navigate the tension between the prophet motive and the prophet motive, it's Solomon. So with this understanding, let's dive right in, and I'm going to share with you three principles. There's so many more, but just three to wet your whistle that the Proverbs gives us in helping us attain wisdom for business or wisdom in the marketplace. And here is the first one. It is hands down the most important thing. It's the foundation of it all that the Proverbs shares with us, and that is that it all begins with honesty and integrity. Man, I wish every follower of Jesus knew this and more importantly lived this today, but we know it's not true. It all begins with honesty and integrity. Proverbs 20 verse 10, written by Solomon himself, is the quintessential proverb on this subject. Look at what he says. He says, "Differing weights and differing measures, both of them are abominable to the Lord." Differing weights and differing measures, both of them are abominable to the Lord. So this proverb is so important that it's actually used three other times in the book, and it bounces off an Old Testament law found in Deuteronomy that expounds on it even more. Listen to what the law says in Deuteronomy 25. It says, and I quote, "You shall not have in your bag differing weights, a large and a small. You shall not have in your house differing measures, a large and a small. You shall have a full and just weight. You shall have a full and just measure, that your days may be prolonged in the land which the Lord your God gives you." And some of you right now are thinking, I don't get it. Like, what's this have to do with honesty, integrity, differing weights, differing measures? Well, what's that all about? Well, think about it. Today, you and I do commerce much differently than they would have 3,000 years ago in antiquity. You and I have dollar bills, and now in the digital age, we have PayPal and things like that. Back then, they didn't have any of that. The way they did commerce back then is through gold and silver as a form of payment, hard stones. And then they would also, however, barter and trade a lot. And this is where differing weights and differing measures came in. Let me explain. When he says don't have differing weights, here's what he's referring to. This would be a scale from a long time ago. It's not from Solomon's age. We didn't have cameras back then. But it is from about, say, 200-300 years ago when we were still using gold and silver as a form of payment. And the way it would work, so simple but so ripe for abuse, is that they would put a 1 ounce stone here, and then you'd measure out about 1 ounce of gold and or silver, and as soon as this dial, as soon as they balanced out, you knew you had 1 ounce. So far, so good. The problem was is that it was common practice back then to use slightly smaller stones on the left side there when you were selling and slightly larger stones when you were buying. In other words, you couldn't see it to the naked eye, but somebody who was selling would use a smaller stone, right? And so they wouldn't need as much gold. If you were buying, you do the opposite. And so they called that differing weights. And it lacked obvious honesty and integrity. And then the other form they had back then was measures. A measure back then, some of you who know Hebrew would call this an ephah. And an ephah back then was a basket, a bushel of about 9.3 gallons. And here's what people would do. They would make their basket just slightly smaller for certain transactions, and then a basket slightly larger for other ones. Again, negligible to the human eye, but definitely lacking integrity and honesty. And what you don't want to miss here is that whenever God's people did that, even though the world did it, and this is harsh, I know, when God's people did it, he called it an abomination. How many of you use that word in your daily language right now? Not too many of you. Maybe your grandparents do, but nobody uses the word abomination anymore because it's harsh, it's strong, and you're right. It's actually one of the strongest terms in the entire Old Testament. It literally means detestable, abhorrent, or as one Hebrew expert says, and I quote, it's a thing of horror, end quote. It was the same word that God used of Israel when she fell into idolatry. The worst sin that Israel ever did. God said that's abominable. Some of you end times people will like this. It's the same word used by Daniel in his prophecy referring to the abomination of desolation. Same Hebrew word referring to the awful things that will happen during the great tribulation or the end times. And so what you don't want to miss is that here in our verse in Proverbs, it's using this same word for those who don't abide by honesty and integrity in their business practices. Let that sink in a moment. Something that the world doesn't mind doing, just having a little different weight, just shaving a little off the top, who's gonna even know? God says he does, and it's an abomination to him. So I know what some of you are thinking right now. You're thinking, well, I'm just sure glad we don't use weights and measures anymore because, I mean, I'm not guilty of this because I don't have a scale and I don't do this. Well, let's talk about how maybe this translates into today. You're right. We don't have scales and counterweights today. We don't use bushels. But let me give you some parallels when you think about it. Quite a few instances where followers of Jesus use differing weights and differing measures in our current business practices. Here's the first one. When we make false representations in business dealings. And I'll just list it for you right now. Sales, contractual negotiations, purchase agreements, partnerships. God tells us to never lie, to always keep our promises. Or I love how the New Testament puts it, let your yes be yes and your no be no. In other words, man up, woman up, be a man or woman of your word. And when we don't do that, God says, differing weights, differing measures. Or how about this one? When we fail to keep financial promises. Ever known a Christian to do that? Whether it be the debt that we promised to owe, that we owe, whether it be wages we promise, or any other conditions that we agreed to in the financial arena, it's differing weights, differing measures when we fail to keep financial promises. Honesty and integrity are on the line. And then a third way, and some of you are going to get real defensive at this right away, but just chill out, be open to what God's word says, is when we lack equity or equality within our employment practices. And I'm not talking here about DEI or anything like that. I'm simply talking about this. Now tell me if this isn't true. Our conservative, capitalistic American culture would say to you and me that we have freedom to pay anybody any wage we choose for the work that they do. And even though this is technically against the law, the common practice would even be to pay a different wage for the same work that different people might do. Because you know in some of your businesses that if you paid them the same, you wouldn't make as much money. And so if nobody knows the difference or somehow you can justify it another way, then that's just fine. Here's the problem with that. If we're living the tension between the profit motive and the prophet motive, you have to ask yourself, if you're open at all to his influence, what would God say about this? And I'm telling you, you know the answer. God says that we treat people, even in our businesses, with fairness and equity, or as Jesus said, and I quote, the laborer is worth his wages. And we are not to be respecters of persons. We are to strive for fair treatment. James chapter 2, don't treat people differently. They're all made in the image of God. And some of you are saying right now, well, Jamie, it's a lot more complicated than this. And you admitted you're not a business guy and you're getting into territory that you might not understand. Fine. Here's what I would say to you. And that is that if you disagree with me, you better have some Bible on your side. Amen. In other words, if all you're going to do is quote to me Adam Smith, and yes, I have read him. I went to Hillsdale College for crying out loud. Von Mises, all the economic stuff. I know that stuff. If you're going to quote that to me and no Bible, I win. The point is we're trying to live the tension between the profit motive that I get and the prophet motive that God wants us to fall into each moment of each day, even in our businesses. And I have one more, and this one's inarguable, and the timing is perfect. It's April 14th, and that is when we cheat on our taxes, right? And some of you have 24 hours to get right on this one. Honestly, I've never understood this. I mean, I only heaven will reveal it. I'm not here to try to make you feel super bad about your life. But look, God sees it. And many Christians I know cheat on their taxes. And they justify by saying, well, I'm not going to give to the government. I don't like what the government's doing. Here's the problem. You don't have Jesus on your side. When you do that, look, they ask Jesus the exact same question that we ask God today. The Greco-Roman tax system was like 10 times worse than anything we experience today. It was brutal. It was ripe with abuses. Nobody liked to pay taxes back then. That's all they talked about. It was bad. And so at one point when Jesus was on this earth, they brought to him this question. They said, well, why should we pay taxes when they're so unfair? And let me read for you a direct quote of what Jesus, how Jesus responded. It says, and Jesus said, show me the coin for the tax. And they brought him a denarius, which was one of the coins back then. And Jesus said to them, whose likeness and description is on this denarius? And they said, well, it's Caesar. So kind of like we have Lincoln on our penny, he noticed Caesar. Then Jesus said to them, why don't you just give to Caesar what is Caesar's and to God the things that are God's? And it's amazing. It says that they were all amazed at his wisdom. What was Jesus saying there? He's just saying if you're a kingdom-minded follower of him, you do have to be in the world, but you're not of the world. And the kingdom trumps all. And yeah, it might be unfair. Well, then bug your legislatures and get the tax code changed. But until then, his followers abide by the law of the day. Why? Don't miss this. Because our honesty and integrity are on the line. People are looking at you and me. And when we do the things that the world does, when we cut the corners, when we fudge in our businesses, and they see that, they might not judge you for it because chances are they're worse than you. But they're not drawn to Jesus because of it. Amen? And God is not pleased with it as well. I could think of a lot more examples, but you get the idea. Solomon made more money than anybody in his day. He mastered international trade and had a thriving import-export business. And he did so, don't miss this because we're going to move on in 20 seconds. He did so by never engaging in differing weights and differing measures. He maintained his integrity and honesty. And at least in this area of his life, he was never an abomination to God. And you don't want to be either. Now, I'm going to encourage you. The hard part of the message is done. So you can kind of breathe easy. You're going to love this second key principle, especially if you're older. If you're younger, I'm not picking on you, but the old people are going to all say amen to this principle because it comes deeply out of our American culture. But it is something we need to wrestle with today, and it is what the Proverbs tells us. And it's this, that when it comes to wisdom for business, there is no shortcut for hard work. Amen? There's no shortcut for hard work. In the first service, I got a real hearty amen at that. You guys are younger in the first service. Honestly, I can see these old people texting their grandchildren right now with a picture of the monitor saying there's no hard work. We don't need to do that today. Let's just understand what the Proverbs says. It's actually really poetic. I love how Solomon puts it. This is kind of cool. In Proverbs 20, verse 13, he says this. He says, "Love not sleep, lest you come to poverty. Open your eyes, and you will have plenty of bread." That's kind of a cool way of saying it, if you ask me. Scholars call this an antithetical parallelism, which is just a fancy phrase for the fact that there are two parallel ideas here, but they are contrasted to each other. Don't sleep to the point that you stay in bed all day and miss work. Rather, open your eyes, get out of bed, and put in a full day's work. I like how one expert says it, commenting on this passage. He says, and I quote, "Sluggards are motivated to untimely sleep because they avoid hard work." And obviously, the result of this is poverty, and the blessing of this is you're going to have some bread or plenty of bread. No hidden messages in that. And then look at one more proverb that Solomon gives us on this topic, this time tackling it from a different vantage point. And this one's probably even more relevant today with where some people are, even many Christians. He says, "A faithful man will abound with blessings." Here it is. "But whoever hastens to be rich will not go unpunished." Whoever hastens to be rich. Let me ask you, and there's no pressure on you, but just raise your hand if you ever met somebody who hastens to be rich. Do you guys know anybody? Raise your hand if you ever met somebody who hastens to be rich. I've met so many people like that. You're saying like what? Well, they get into business ventures that are super high risk and doesn't really cost much up front, and then they whine and moan that it all fell apart. Or how about this one? They want to work maybe 4 or 5 hours a day. They're not really motivated to work, and then whine and moan. Nobody's paying them more. Or how about this one? And this is going to step on some toes, but come on, we got to wrestle with this, gang. How about those who just fall into gambling for a living? Gambling. I mean, again, I don't talk about this much. People ask me once in a while, what's your view of gambling? I say, well, at the very least, I can tell you this. I'm not sure it's healthy for the soul, and I've never met anybody who got too rich off of that. And here's why, is that the house generally has stacked it so that the house wins. In other words, casinos would not be in business if they weren't making a profit. Casinos would not be in business if the majority of the people were losing their money. And you might say, well, it's fun to lose money. Fine. If you want to treat it as entertainment, that's fine. I just know too many people who have fallen into a trap where they spend way too much money on gambling, that they ruin their future because of that. Call it an addiction. I don't know. Call it whatever. And the Bible says that's a rather unhealthy thing. And don't even get me going on the lottery. Again, I know some of you play the lottery. That's fine. I can't call it a sin, but I don't like being behind you at Circle K. I really don't. I'm trying to get my code. Take this number, this number, this number. And I'm like, oh, seriously, you're not going to win. That's what I want to say. But I don't say that because it's not for me to judge. But what are the chances? And again, I know why. Don't send me an email. I know why people play the lottery. I know why. You're doing it because it gives you a little smile and it gives you a little hope and something to hang on to for today, you know, and you're going, oh, if just only. And again, if that does it for you, knowing that you're going to lose, fine. Just don't spend too much money on that stuff. Why? Because those endeavors rarely work. People who want to get rich quick, I'm telling you, rarely work. And some of you are going, no, but I know somebody did this. Right, that's an outlier. Read the book Outliers. That's an outlier. That's somebody who doesn't fit the bell curve. Chances are you're not an outlier. So I don't think you want to do that. The best thing the Bible says is to get up, work hard, put your hand to the plow, don't look back, and see if God doesn't bless you that way. Because there's a really good chance that he would. Once again, Solomon, the consummate businessman, tells us to be faithful, to avoid get-rich-quick schemes, and that this stands the best chance for blessings to come your way. It served me well over the years. So, to sum up, because we got one more, and then we're going to let you go. It all begins with honesty and integrity. There's no shortcut for hard work. And then a third and very liberating principle, I'm done beating you guys up, is this. And that is to pursue increasing skill and ingenuity in your work. The Bible really says this. Pursue increasing skill and ingenuity in your work. So one last time, look at what the proverb says. In Proverbs 22, verse 29, it says, "Do you see a man skillful in his work? He will stand before kings. He will not stand before obscure men." You're saying, well, what does that mean? Well, obviously the word skillful there means, I looked it up, skillful, somebody who's good at what they do, somebody who's honed a skill over the years. We'll talk about that more in a second here. And when it says that he will stand before kings, in that culture what that meant was, is that if somebody was really good at what they've done, if they'd honed their skill over the years, there's a good chance they would stand before the king and get a commission from the king, money from the king, to do their work for him. And that's what it means when it says he won't stand before obscure men. That just means low-standing men who, quite frankly, can't do anything for you with your skill. So I love how Bruce Waltke says it in his commentary on Proverbs. This is really good. He says, "This aims to motivate the son to become competent in order to rise to his greatest potential." You see, God's concerned about that. God's concerned that we take the gifts and the passions, the natural talents that he has given to each one of us, and you have some, and to spend our lives honing those as best we can and see what he does with that. That's wisdom for the marketplace. I gotta tell you, out of all three principles we're looking at today, this one is hands down for me, and it's been my best friend. I didn't need to be taught to be honest in my work because my dad drilled that one into me. And quite frankly, in the pastorate, you gotta be that way anyways, right? I was never taught to work hard. I mean, I was taught that. I didn't need to hear that from the Bible because my dad grew up in the Great Depression and became a self-made man. He drilled that into his boys, that we work hard. So both of those things I got even before I came home to Jesus. But this one here, to pursue skill and ingenuity in my work, now that one was huge. And I want to tell you why. Some of you older people will smile at this because you remember this day. Back in the day, when a young man or woman wanted to go into the ministry, I don't know why this is so. We don't do this here at Scottsdale Bible Church. Back in the day, if you showed any interest in the ministry, remember this, Bill? They would say, why don't we start you with youth? And the mindset was the youth are already messed up and you can't mess them up anymore. And so they don't want you to start you with adults. We'll start you in youth ministry and kind of baptize you that way. And then even in that, they said, why don't you just run events? So we don't want you really teaching them because that could mess them up even further. Just run burger bashes and events and things like this. So back in the early 1980s, when I dared open my mouth that I was interested in serving God, they said, well, let's start you with the youth. Here was the problem. I didn't like youth. I didn't like them then, and I don't like them now. I mean, it just wasn't my cup of tea. I don't do well with them. I remember running a campus life group, you know, and these kids were all messed up. They said, shut up, we're going to learn about God. That didn't go over very well. So I wasn't good with youth, so they started me with youth. And then they started me with event planning, and I'm like going, I want to go into the ministry. I don't want to be an event planner. And I don't have gifts in administration, and I'm not a shepherd. I'm not any of these. And I almost dropped out because they started me there. And then I got through seminary, didn't know what I wanted to do. And I went and worked at a large church like Scottsdale Bible Church, and they had the opposite mindset. They said to me, we're not going to start you with youth. We're going to put you with some fellow adults and teach you how to do ministry. But then they said, but before that, and this was brand new to me, here I have a Master's of Divinity degree. This took me 4 years to get. I'm supposed to know the Bible. And they said, but before that, we need to find out what you're gifted at. And they said, what are your spiritual gifts? And honestly, I said, well, I like jogging, and I like reading, and things like that. They go, you don't know what a spiritual gift is. And they put me through a class on spiritual gifts. And I learned that when I got saved, 8 years before that, that the Bible says that the Holy Spirit came into my life and God gifted me in certain areas, even above my natural talents. And then I discovered what some of those gifts are. No one has all of them, but there's a few of them. And they are things like teaching, leadership, wisdom, knowledge, mercy, hospitality, administration, shepherding. These are all gifts that God has given to his people. And I realized that I didn't have the vast majority of them. And even worse, up to that point in ministry, people had been trying to get me in areas where I was not gifted nor impassioned. Think youth and running events. It wasn't what God made me to do. And when this church freed me up to realize I only have two gifts out of 22 mentioned in the Bible, I only got two of them, and that they were in teaching and leadership, not shepherding, not administration, not hospitality, yuck. I don't have gifts in that at all. That my gifts are in teaching and leadership. Here's what I know, gang. My life exploded. Because I made a decision then, circa 1989, that I was going to pour 80% of my effort into those gifted areas. Now, listen to me closely. I said 80%. You're saying, why not 100%? Because think about it. I just made fun of hospitality. I just made fun of mercy giving. I make fun of administration. But the body of Christ needs all those things. Even more importantly, I do have to function well in those areas. Amen? I need to show mercy. I need to administrate when God calls me to. I need to show hospitality. You need to have a demonstrated performance in all those areas. But what God says, and this will be really relevant to you in about 2 minutes, is that if you're a believer in Jesus, think of a blip on a screen. It's like going steady here, and all of a sudden, boom, you excel in a certain area. He's gifted you in a certain area. It's a promise. Romans 12, verse 4, it says, now to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit has been given. To each one. And last I learned, that includes you. And when I discovered for me it was teaching and leadership, I committed way back then that I was going to spend 80% of my time honing those two things. If you go up to my library right now, I have about 3,000 books in my library here at church. I love to read, but three shelves of them alone are all on leadership. Secular, Christian, anything I could devour back in the day. Entire swatches of my library are on theology and teaching because that's what God called me to do. Anytime I was asked to teach, no matter where it was, I'd do it. Here's why that was important. Malcolm Gladwell, years ago, some of you might have read it, wrote a book called Outliers. And in that, he outlined what he called the 10,000-hour rule. And he pointed out that anybody who is successful in anything he has been able to show has put at least 10,000 hours into honing their skill. So whether it's Tiger Woods swinging a club, whether it's Michael Jordan shooting a basket, whether it's Bill Gates working on a computer. He pointed out that there's a minimum of 10,000 hours required to become proficient at what you do. At that time, it's probably about 20 years ago, whenever I wrote that book, maybe 15 years ago, I did the math at how much time I had spent honing my leadership and my teaching skills. I added up all the sermons that I'd preached, the study I'd put into it, all the preparation, and I barely eked out, way back then, 10,000 hours. And I knew that I was on my way to being used by God. I knew that that's where he wanted me to pour my energies. And it was so liberating to my service to him. Now let's talk about you. Some of you are thinking right now, well, I'm not sure I have any gifts. Hogwash. Of course you do. If you're a follower of Jesus and the Spirit lives in you, which he does if you're a follower, you have at least one, probably a couple, spiritual gifts. Even if you're here today seeking and you're not a follower of Jesus yet, you were born, amen, and you were born with natural talents. You were born with areas that God has made you good in. Everybody's different that way. And here's the saying I adopted years ago when I discovered all of this. And many people don't believe this, but it's true. And that is, because of this principle of pursuing skill and ingenuity, everybody is a 10 somewhere. Let me repeat that. Everybody is a 10 somewhere. The problem is most people just don't know where. Most people have never slowed down enough or parked enough in front of this concept to discover where it is they truly are gifted at. But if you can discover that, if you can find that area, and it's really not that hard, you network with other people, you do an audit of your life, you try different things, you'll find that God indeed has made you, excuse me, good at something. And because he made you that way, and as the old saying goes, God doesn't make no junk, because of that, you are a 10 in that area, at least as far as he's concerned. He will use you in that area to be the best you you can be. This is not psychological, it's spiritual. It's how God has made you. And for me, it was liberating. I never touched youth again, and I never planned an event after that time, because it's not how God made me. And again, I love youth. If you have a youth, I love youth. Okay, I'm not saying that. I got three myself. I raised three teenagers, barely. But the reality is that my strength and the areas I honed were elsewhere. And it's been super liberating for me. It's wisdom for business. The Proverbs is filled with this. And folks, here's what you need to know as we wrap this up. We've just scratched the surface today. I gave you three principles that I found in about 3 days of study. It wasn't hard. Last week, I shared with you that as we go through this series, we're going to look at about 50 Proverbs. And do you remember how many Proverbs I said there are in the entire book? 900 of them. So here's your homework. Start reading this book. And don't try to read too much of it. Read it until something hits you and then think about it. Pause on it. Let that guide you through the day. And as you are reading through this book, be on the lookout for your business, for your marketplace, for your schooling, whatever it is that consumes you throughout the week. Because my guess is there's a lot more in there for you and for me. But I've given you enough to get you going. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word that, again, is so relevant to our lives. And God, I gotta believe that even what we've covered today over the last 40 minutes, there's something for each one of us. Lord, it might be that whack over the head to get with the program of honesty and integrity. Our testimony depends on it. God, it might be for some of us that we need to work just a little bit harder, maybe smarter, but stop being, quite frankly, lazy and to start putting more energy into what we do. Lord, for others of us, for me, I know the great friend for me is that pursuing skill and ingenuity. That's been so fun, hard, but fun. And I thank you for the blessing that comes with that. And Lord, help us to discover other nuggets of truth in this book that's so relevant to our lives. Thanks for this time together. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen. Thank you. Well, we've all been challenged, right? My prayer for us this week is that we are going to be focused and that we're going to be faithful in the way God has given us this wisdom to do business dealing. So have a wonderful Sunday. Have a great week. We'll see you next week.
Well, thank you, Pastor Jamie. And what an incredible message. Thank you, Pastor Jamie. And what an incredible message. I love this Proverbs wisdom series. And guys, please continue to look introspectively. Look at your own life. Where do these principles apply to your life? God is making a difference in every one of us.
Yeah. Yeah. And if anything hit you today, if you just want to talk with someone or pray with someone, know that we are available for you here online. You can go to scottsdalebible.com/live prayer. And if you type in your information and ask for prayer, there are real people like me and other volunteers on the side ready to pray for you and receive you and are here for you. So SBC Online, we love you so much. Hope you have a wonderful, amazing day, and we will see you very soon. See you.